This is a continuation of the previous topic, okay? Special deaths. Special deaths. There are three kinds or types: judicial death, euthanasia, suicide. Okay? What is judicial death? It is death caused by a court sentence held to be legal but unjust. Okay? Under Philippine Constitution, it provides that cruel and unusual punishment shall not be inflicted. Punishment are cruel when they involve torture or a lingering death. But the punishment is not cruel when it is non-brutal or inhumane. Many inhumane and uncivilized punishment, formerly known, the infliction of which tend to be barbarized present civilization. Okay? So, in Philippine setting, we adopt lethal injection, okay, as the highest punishment in the commission of a crime. However, lethal injection right now is suspended, okay? It is not considered cruel, okay? It is commensurate to the crime committed. What is prohibited by law is the killing of a person using torture or using barbaric approaches, okay? Cruel approaches. However, lethal injection is a humane way of killing a person, okay? Because the person that is killed is the one who committed a heinous crime, okay? Not ordinary victims or not innocent victims, but those persons who committed crimes against humanity, okay? Crimes against torture and etc. Death penalty. Okay, this is just a matter of reading. Please refer to your book. Argument in favor of death penalty. Okay, so there are two school of thoughts. The one in favor and the one against. Okay, their arguments are, for those in favor, it is the only method of eliminating the hopeless enemy of society. Okay, in order to deter lawless violence. Okay, it determines potential criminals as no other form of punishment does. Its brutalizing effect is an unproven assumption, okay? Society is relieved of the support of those who continually war upon it. It is a positive selective agency to wipe out the stock of reformable criminals, okay? However, another school of thought who are against death penalty contends that it is an irreversible penalty. Mistaken judgments as to guilt can no longer be cured, okay? For example, that person who was wrongfully killed was innocent. You cannot get back the life that you took, okay? It is not reformative, okay? It has no deterrent effect. There is no proof of diminished criminality. It is cold-blooded and deliberate kind of murder. It is retributive or revengeful, okay? However, in the Philippine setting, we adopt the school of thought of those who are in favor, okay, in order to deter or discourage criminality. Method of judicial death. Before or in other countries, they adopt electrocution, musketry, gas chamber, hanging, beheading or decapitation, lethal injection. Okay, in the Philippines, we adopted the lethal injection as the most humane way of killing a criminal. Death by electrocution. Before we used death by electrocution, okay, by the use of electric chair, as you can see here in the image. Electrocution is death or severe injury by electric shock, electric current passing through the body. Okay, this is enshrined in these articles. Article 81, 82, 83, 84. Maybe in other countries. Death by hanging. Okay, in the Middle Ages, they used to kill persons by using a rope. They hang those criminals. The cause of death in judicial hanging is controversial and often attributed to hangman's fracture of the second cervical vertebra. Cause of death, rupture of the cervical muscles, asphyxia, syncope, cerebral anemia. Okay? Death by musketry. It is a method of execution of death penalty. Is applied to military personnel and decided by the court martials. Less heinous than death by hanging. Okay? So, this is usually adopted by military men. Okay? They shoot to kill a person. Death by gas chamber. Of course, during the Holocaust, they utilized this approach. The convict is enclosed in a compartment and an obnoxious or asphyxiating gas is introduced. The most common gas used is carbon monoxide. Okay? Carbon monoxide, very rampant in our streets because it is the one coming out in our cars. The convict will not be removed from the gas chamber unless he is pronounced dead by a physician. Okay. Other methods of capital punishment in other countries, beheading in the Middle East. Okay. They use beheading. Crucifixion during the Middle Ages. Beating, cutting, precipitation from a height. Destruction by wild beast, okay? You are being fed to the lions. Flaying, impaling, stoning, strangling, smothering, drowning, and etc. What is euthanasia? The word euthanasia originates from the Greek word, okay? Otherwise known as mercy killing. It is an act or practice of painlessly putting to death persons suffering from painful and incurable diseases or incapacitating physical disorder or allowing them to die by withholding treatment or withdrawing artificial life support measures. Okay? Mercy killing. Actually, it is illegal here to commit euthanasia. Types of euthanasia. Active euthanasia, meaning it is the putting to death of a person in compliance with the wishes of the person or the patient to shorten his sufferings. Okay? Passive euthanasia, accelerate death, but the natural of the disease is allowed to have its way to extinguish the life of a person. Consequently, the two concepts of passive euthanasia, orthothanasia and dysthanasia. Okay? Two concepts of passive euthanasia. In orthothanasia, when an incurably ill person is allowed to die a natural death without the application of any operation or treatment procedure. Okay? You just leave that person to die a natural death. Without any treatment, without any management. Another, dysthanasia, when there is an attempt to extend the lifespan of a person by the use of extraordinary treatments without which the patient would have died earlier. Okay? Ways of performing euthanasia. Administration of a lethal dose of poison, overdosage, or use of other pain-relieving drugs, injection of air into the bloodstream, that is very dangerous, okay? Application of strong electric currents, okay? However, in the Philippines, it is illegal to commit euthanasia. I don't know with other countries. I think there are laws in other countries which legalizes euthanasia or mercy killing. Failure to institute the necessary management procedure which is essential to preserve the life of the patient. Failure to perform tracheostomy when there is marked distress in breathing due to laryngeal obstruction. Okay? It is a protocol in hospital to perform tracheostomy if there are any laryngeal obstruction in order to save the life of the patient. However, if the patient wish to die, then the doctor will not anymore perform life-saving protocols. Failure to give transfusion in severe hemorrhage. Depriving the child of nutrition, removal of patient from a respirator when voluntarily breathing is not possible. Who may perform euthanasia? Okay, like I've said, in the Philippines, euthanasia is illegal. You can be imprisoned, okay? However, there are provisions in Philippine law that a person who is committing suicide will not be punished, okay? But those person assisting that person committing suicide will be punished, okay? So, the patient himself, the person himself who wants to put an end to his life commits suicide. The person must be given an eye of sympathy rather than an eye of penalty by law. Suicide is not a crime in our jurisdiction because a person committing suicide is a moral wreck. Okay? The physician, with or without the knowledge and consent of the patient, even if physician has merciful motive behind doing euthanasia, his act is punishable in spite of the patient's consent. Okay? So in our jurisdiction, in the Philippine setting, euthanasia is illegal. You can be penalized by law. If the physician assists a person for suicide, the law imposes upon him the penalty of prision mayor. Okay? Prision mayor, this is a penalty, imprisonment ranging from 6 years and 1 day to 12 years. Okay? If the physician lends his assistance to another, to the extent of doing the killing himself, he shall be punished by reclusion temporal, okay? 12 years and 1 day to 20 years, okay? The span of imprisonment. If the suicide with the assistance of the physician is not consummated, the penalty of arresto mayor in its medium and maximum period shall be imposed, okay? If poison was administered by the physician to the patient without the knowledge and consent of the patient, then it is murder, okay? Treachery is inherent to the act of poisoning, and treachery qualifies the killing to murder. In other jurisdictions, the modern attitude is to allow physicians to perform euthanasia in some special cases, okay, maybe in other countries. So, poison qualifies the killing into murder, okay, by the use of poison. If there is no intent there is no qualification, then the case that can be filed is homicide. But in this case, there is treachery. So it qualifies the crime to murder. So death by hanging. They use ropes in the Middle Ages. Suicide. Suicide or self-destruction is usually an unfortunate consequence of mental disorder and social disorganization. Okay? So there is a problem in mental health, depression. Okay? As a medical practitioner, you should always take note, because everybody, especially nowadays, everybody is affected mentally due to the pandemic, due to widespread of fear. Okay? So you should take note as medical practitioner. Okay? What are the signs of suicide? What are the signs of depression? What are the signs of mental illness? And how you handle it? Reasons of underreporting suicide cases. So, of course, there is underreporting. That's why, because sometimes if the police will not rule suicide right away, they have to investigate all angles. That's why there are underreporting. Or they can declare a case as a dead case, okay, which are under investigation. Okay, not yet a closed case, which is investigation has become final. Okay, so under reporting of suicide cases, the strong opposition of family member, friends, physicians, or attorney due to shame or for beneficiaries. Of course, if you have insurance, there are provisions in the insurance that if you commit suicide, then your insurance will be forfeited. So that's why they will not report it as suicide. Okay? Maybe they will report it as homicide, murder, or accident. Okay? Suicide is not conscious, intentional, and self-destructive manner of death. If there is any lack of these generally accepted standards, then the death is not accepted as suicide, okay? Of course, police will investigate and they will rule out situation, okay? That is why sometimes, even though it is suicide, it will be reported as other crimes. Most cases at pre-adolescence, okay? Most cases of suicide are usually minors, okay? Pre-adolescence. More cases reported in male than female. Most reported death patient had history of major depression, okay? Like what I've said before, depression is really one of the reason of suicide, okay? If you are a medical practitioner, take note of the signs of depression that would lead a person to commit suicide. For example, personal belongings of the depressed person, he will be giving it away. Okay, that is one sign that maybe this person wants to commit suicide. So you must intervene. Okay, intervene directly. Occurs at most convenient and common place like home, hotel, heightened building, rivers, etc. Psychological classification of suicide. Okay, these are the classification of suicide psychologically. First degree, planned self-murder. Second degree, impulsive, provocational, unplanned self-murder. Third degree, accidental suicide. Intention of death is low. Suicide under circumstances like alcohol, drug, okay, person drinks alcohol in order to commit suicide or takes drug because it removes inhibitions, okay. Self-destruction due to self-avoidance like excessive alcoholism, smoking, drug abuse, and etc. justifiable suicide due to terminal illness or mental disorder. Okay, maybe this is applicable in other countries because in our presently in our setting, suicide is not accepted. Okay. Common methods of suicide: use of drugs, fire, drowning, electrocution, poison, jumping from high places, stabbing, suffocation by plastic bag, hanging, okay, and so on. Suicide and drug: due to long-term several doses of drugs, alcohol, or combination of drug therapy, patient fall into automatism state. This is accidental rather than suicide, okay? Automatism means action without conscious thought or intention, okay? That the person is just passive, just automatic, without unconscious, doing things unconsciously due to use of drugs. Evidences that will infer death is suicidal. So these are the instances when a medical legal officer can say that this person committed suicide. First, history of depression, unresolved personal problem or mental disease, previous attempt of harm to oneself, if committed by infection of wounds are located inaccessible to the hand, self-destruction may be found in the body of the victim, presence of suicide note, suicide scene in a place not in a public view, evidence that will rule out homicide, murder, parricide. But these are disputable presumptions, okay? These are presumptions that a person committed suicide, but they are disputable, okay? Maybe it was planned. Maybe the person was forced to write a suicide note. That's why police officers will investigate all angles. And that is why there are many dead cases. Dead cases means unresolved crimes. Not yet, the investigation has not yet finished because of lack of evidence. Okay? Overview of starvation. Okay? This is another type of killing in other countries. They starve a person to death. So this is the graph. You just read it. So the ultimate result would be loss of homeostasis in the body. Okay, loss of balance in the body. This is just a matter of reading. Please refer to your book. Death from starvation. It is the deprivation of a regular and constant supply of food and water, which is necessary to normal health of a person. Types of starvation. Acute starvation. Necessary food has been suddenly and completely withheld from a person. And then there is chronic starvation. There is a gradual or deficient supply of food. So, causes of starvation, it can be suicidal, homicidal, or accidental. Okay? So, if it is suicidal, hunger strike. Person was in hunger strike. Or mistaken belief that people can live without food. Or desire to lose weight. For example, those people having anorexia. Okay, in homicidal, deprival of food for helpless, illegitimate children, feeble-minded persons, and then punishment or act of revenge by deliberate in an enclosed place without food or water. Accidental, scarcity of food, water during famines or drought. Okay, especially in countries, poor countries. Entombment of minors caused by landslide and etc. Length of survival, LOS. The human body without food loses one of over 24th of its weight daily, and a loss of 40% results to death. Okay? Factors that influence LOS are age, condition of the body, gender, environment, while it depends upon presence or absence of water, partial or complete withdrawal of food, and surroundings. So, these are the circumstances that will affect the length of survival of a person. Okay. Signs and symptoms of starvation. Body wasting, decreased heart rate, decreased respiratory rate, decreased metabolism, decreased body temperature, impaired vision, organ failure, decreased resistance to disease, depression, anxiety, food-related dreams. Of course, if you do not eat, you will lose nutrients in the body, and our body, the food of which are vitamins, minerals, nutrients in a cellular level. Okay, that's why it is important to eat nutritious foods. Okay. Postmortem appearances, external examination. In children, skeleton shows spinal curvature, rickets, and dental defects. Face is pale. The skin is inelastic and pigmented. Edema around ankles and inside the thighs. In wet type, there is marked edema, ascites, and pleural effusion. Eyes are sunken. Cheekbones are apparent and prominent. Hair is dry, lusterless, and brittle. Okay? These are the appearances upon examination of a post-mortem body. Internal examination. Loss of adipose tissue from omentum, mesentery, and perirenal fat stores. Atrophy of organs except the brain with reduction in size shows changes similar to premature senility. Heart is small from brown atrophy. Lungs are pale and are collapsed. Stomach and intestine shows atrophy of all coats and mucosa is stained with bile. Okay? That's the appearance of a post-mortem body internally. Effects of chronic starvation. Deprivation of protein in the diet causing anemia, leukopenia. Absence of various vitamins like vitamins A, B, C, or D causing hyperkeratosis, neuritis or beriberi, hemorrhage, osteomalacia. So, as a medico-legal investigator, these questions arises, okay? Whether death was caused by starvation or the determination of the cause of starvation. Now, let's go to another chapter. Disposal of the dead body. Disposal of human corpses, also called final disposition, is the practice and process of dealing with the remains of a deceased human being. Disposal methods may need to account for the fact that soft tissues will decompose relatively rapidly, while skeleton will remain intact for thousands of years under certain conditions. Executor's right of custody superior to the right of spouse dead body. Okay, this provision is just a matter of reading, and also our previous discussions are just matters of reading. So please refer to your book. Okay, now let's go to the Revised Administrative Code of the Philippines. Under section 1103, persons charged with duty of burial. The immediate duty of burying the body of a deceased person, regardless of the ultimate liability for the expense thereof shall devolve upon the persons herein below specified. Okay? So, if the deceased was a married man or woman, the duty of burial shall devolve upon the surviving spouse if he or she possesses sufficient means to pay the necessary expenses. If the deceased was an unmarried man or woman or a child and left any kin, the duty of burial shall devolve upon the nearest kin of the deceased. If they be adults and within the Philippines and in possession of sufficient means to defray the necessary expenses. If the deceased left no spouse or kin possessed of sufficient means to defray the necessary expenses, as provided in the two foregoing subsection, the duty of a burial shall devolve upon the municipal authorities. Okay? So, if the family members has no money, it is incumbent upon the government to bury a dead person. Okay? Any person upon whom the duty of burying a dead body is imposed by law shall perform such duty within 48 hours after death, having ability to do so. Okay? Under the law, upon 48 hours of death, a person must be buried. Okay, but the practice here in the Philippines, because other relatives are still far away, so it will take like 7 days. Okay? Okay, so another section of the Revised Administrative Code, section 1104, right of custody to body. Any person charged by law with the duty of burying the body of a deceased person is entitled to the custody of such body for the purpose of burying it, except when an inquest is required by law for the purpose of determining the cause of death, and in case of death due to or accompanied by a dangerous communicable disease, such body shall, until buried, remain in the custody of the local board of health or the local health officer, or if there be no such, then in the custody of the municipal council. Okay, as stated by this provision, if the body, for example, right now we are in a pandemic, right? So if a person is found to have COVID-19 and died due to the disease, that person will be cremated, okay? The right to the body belongs to the government due to the danger of the disease, okay? Concept of possession. The right of custody over a dead body means possession. Possession means the holding of a thing or enjoyment of a right. The possession of a thing means two things, either in the concept of ownership or the holder of a thing keeping it while the ownership belongs to another. Okay? So, literally speaking, the right of custody does not mean ownership of a dead body. The possessor cannot exercise the full rights of ownership. Kenny, a legal luminary in his book, Criminal Law, cited a case of a group of individuals known as Resurrection Men who used to disinter dead bodies from cemeteries and sell them to the anatomy departments of medical colleges. Since the law provides that the crime of theft or robbery cannot be committed on things which have no owner, these people were not successfully prosecuted. Okay? In the case of Phillips versus Montreal General Hospital, decided in Quebec, Canada, it has been held that there is a right of property in human remains, at least in a limited sense. The right of possession of a corpse is equivalent to ownership, and any unlawful interference with that right is an actionable wrong. Okay? So, it depends upon the country or the setting. Depends upon the law of the country whether or not a body is considered a thing that can be owned. Okay? The surviving spouse has the preferential right and duty to make arrangements for the funeral of the deceased spouse and to decide how the remains should be disposed. Executor's right of custody superior to the right of spouse dead body. So, if ever the deceased left a will stating, among other things, the manner on which his body will be disposed, such provision of the will, if validly executed and allowed, will prevail over the provisions of the administrative code. So, if it is the wish of the person and he left a will, then that will be followed. Okay? Because a will is the last words of a deceased person. So, if the will provides that upon my death, my body will be given to the school for study, then the wife will be dispossessed of such right to bury the body. Okay? But in the absence of a testamentary disposition, the right of the surviving spouse is paramount. Okay? So, so as a medical practitioner, you should check for any will or any advance directives. Okay? Methods of disposal of dead body. Embalming. It is an artificial way of preserving the body of the deceased in which a chemical component is used. The amount that is inserted is 6 to 8 quarts via the major blood vessel. The internal organs are removed from the abdomen and thoracic cavities, soaked in antiseptic and then returned to the body. In some cases, alcohol is added to reduce the chemical odor and glycerin is added to reduce the water loss from the body. So this is one way of preserving a dead body. In our setting, we use formalin, okay, to preserve dead bodies. Burial or inhumations. The body of the deceased should be present for burial within 48 hours after death. According to the Revised Administrative Code of the Philippines, Section 1092, no embalmed cadaver shall remain unburied after 48 hours after the death has occurred. The permit is only valid till 48 hours, and after the time limit is crossed, a new permit should be obtained. Okay? So when burying a body, you should have permit. Exception to these rules are when the body is under legal investigation and when it is authorized by the local health authorities. Okay? These are just matters of reading and are self-explanatory provision. So, refer to your book. If the body is embalmed, it is implied that it should be buried. If the deceased had any communicable disease, then the body should be buried rapidly under 12 hours. Okay? In the Republic of the Philippines, which is a tropical country, the time limits should be brought down to 24 hours as the body decomposes rapidly in the tropical climate of the country. But in the Philippine setting, because the Filipinos are closely knitted families, okay? That's why it extends to a week. Okay? Necessity of the death certificate. A death certificate has to be obtained according to the Revised Administrative Code, Section 1087 of the code, for the burial of the body except in case of certain emergencies. So it has to be provided by the attending physician, failing which it can be provided by the local health officer. If no such authority is available, then it would be furnished by the mayor, the secretary, or any office holding authority of the local municipality. Okay, so death certificate should be provided because it is proof, okay? Proof of death, and it is mandatory for if you collect your benefits like death benefits, burial assistance, insurance, and so on and so forth, okay? Okay, this is just a matter of reading under the law. Under the law of sanitation, the code of sanitation, section 91, PD 856, it states that no body will be buried without the proper death certificate provided to the municipal secretary within 48 hours of the embalming of the dead body. The death certificate will be provided by the attending physician, in the absence of whom it will be provided by the local health officer, in the absence of whom it will be provided by the mayor, the secretary, or any office holding authority of the municipal. Okay, so you can ask the death certificate from those individuals enumerated. So under the sanitation code, section 91, it states that if the assigning authority suspects that the cause of death of the deceased was due to violence or crime, they shall immediately notify the concerned authorities, and the cadaver will not be buried, and the death certificate will be voided or nullified. Okay, so upon investigation of those authority, and they found out that death was due to the commission of a crime, then further investigation will be conducted. Okay, the certificate will again not be issued until permission is obtained from the provincial or city fiscal if the cause of death is through violence or a crime. Section 90 of the Code of Sanitations. It shall be unlawful for any person to bury remains in places other than those legally authorized in conformity. A burial ground shall at least be 25 meters distant from any dwelling house, and no house shall be constructed within the same distance from any burial ground. Okay? So, these are the requirements in order to construct cemeteries. Okay? No burial ground shall be located within 50 meters from any source of water supply. Of course, because decomposition will seep into the watershed areas if it is near, and it is dangerous because the water supply will be contaminated. Under the Civil Code, Article 305, the duty and the right to make arrangements for the funeral of a relative shall be in accordance with the order established for support under Article 294. Okay? So the order mentioned in this article is as follows. The spouse, the descendants of the nearest degree, the ascendant, also of the nearest degree, and then the brothers and sisters. So, they are the ones who will make arrangement. Okay? So, if they can defray the expenses. However, if they don't have any money or they cannot pay the burial, then it is incumbent upon the government to assist and bury the dead. So, Article 306 of the Civil Code, it provides, every funeral shall be in keeping with the social position of the deceased. And then Article 307 of the same code provides the funeral shall be in accordance with the express wishes of the deceased. In the absence of such expression, his religious belief or affiliation shall determine the funeral's rites. In case of doubt, the form of funeral shall be decided upon by the person obliged to make arrangement for the same after consulting the other members of the family. Okay? Just a matter of reading, guys. This is a provision of law. It can be found in the Civil Code of the Philippines. Again, under the Civil Code of the Philippines, Article 309, any person who shows disrespect to the dead or wrongfully interferes with a funeral shall be liable to the family of the deceased for damages, material or moral. Okay? So, if anybody disrespects the dead or the family members, you can file a case in court for damages. Okay? Under Article 132 of the Revised Penal Code, interruption of religious worship, the penalty of prison correctional in its minimum period shall be imposed upon any public officer or employee who shall prevent or disturb the ceremonies or manifestations of any religion. Okay? So, to interrupt religious practice or worship is a criminal offense and the perpetrator can be imprisoned. Under the Revised Penal Code, Article 133, offending the religious feeling, the penalty of arresto mayor in its maximum period to prison correctional in its minimum period shall be imposed upon anyone who offends the religious feeling in a place devoted to religious worship. So, under the same law, Article 85, unless claimed by his family, the corpse of the culprit shall, upon the completion of the legal proceedings subsequent to the execution, be turned over to the Institute of Learning or Scientific Research, first applying for it for the purpose of study and investigation, provided that such institute shall take charge of the decent burial of the remain. Okay? So, if the body remains unclaimed by the family members, then by virtue of this law, it will be given to learning institutions that applies to collect the body. Under the Revised Administrative Code, Section 1105, in cases of death due to dangerous communicable diseases or due to any epidemic recognized by the Director of Health, the body of the deceased shall not be taken to any place of public assembly except the adult members of the immediate family of the deceased, his nearest friends, not exceeding 4, and other person whose attendance is absolutely necessary. Okay? Just like now, if you are afflicted with COVID-19 and you die, you get cremated. The body will not be given to the family members. Okay? So, it is sad that if you die with COVID-19 because your family members will not say goodbye to you. Okay? In case of death due to other causes, the right to hold public funerals in an orderly manner and to take the remains of the deceased into churches or other places for this purpose shall not be interfered. So, under the Code of Sanitation, Section 91, when the cause of death is a dangerous communicable disease, the remains shall be buried within 12 hours after death. They shall not be taken to any place of public assembly. Only adult members of the family of the deceased may be permitted to attend the funeral. Okay? So, in another law, it is also strict if The dead body has communicable diseases. Okay? Disposing of the dead body in the sea. Some dead bodies are not buried, embalmed, or cremated, but thrown overboard in an open sea, provided that the deceased is not suffering from dangerous communicable diseases. Such manner of disposal may be the will of the deceased or a part of a religious practice. Okay? I don't know if this is applicable in the Philippines, but there is no law allowing this practice. Okay? However, maybe there are exceptions, like if it is a religious practice, okay, or if it is based on the will of the dead person. So under the Revised Administrative Code, Section 1093, permit for conveyance of body to sea for burial, okay? The body must be transported in the manner prescribed by the Municipal Board of Health, if such there be, and the marine laws governing burial at sea must be complied with, okay? I think this is a dead provision because, of course, in our time today, it is discouraged to throw dead bodies in the sea. Cremation. Cremation is the pulverization of the body into ashes by the application of heat. The body must first be identified before cremation, and no cremation must be made unless there is a permit to do so. Cremation must be made in a crematory made for the purpose. Okay? In recent events, of course, COVID-19, a dreaded disease. If you are afflicted with such disease and will eventually die, you will be cremated in order to discourage transmission. Okay? Cremation is the grind of the dead person's body into ashes by burning. The body must first be identified before cremation. In this process, the time to transform the dead body into ashes depends on the degree of heat, duration of application of heat, and the physical condition of the body. In gas incinerator, 4 hours required to transform body into ashes. Okay? So, depends upon the status of the body. So, at least 4 hours is required in order to make it into ashes. So, this is an example of cremation. Okay? You can review this image. So, the deceased person must be identified properly. And then, the body is prepared. Medical devices are removed, like jewelry. Okay? And then, the body is placed in a cremation container of wood or other combustible material. And then, moved to the cremation chamber. And then, application of very intense heat for a minimum of 4 hours. A magnet is used to remove bits of metal that may be left behind. The remains are ground to create what we think of as ashes. When complete, the remains are transferred to a temporary container or an urn provided by the family. This will be given to the family's representative. Instances when permission for cremation must not be granted. If the deceased left a written direction that he or she must not be cremated, okay? So, these are just in ordinary cases. However, if you are afflicted with a communicable disease like COVID-19, cremation is mandatory by law. If the exact identity of the deceased has not yet been definitely ascertained. When the exact cause of death cannot be definitely ascertained and further inquiry or examination may be needed. So, if autopsy is necessary, then the cremation can be delayed. Use of the body for scientific purposes. So under the Code of Sanitation, use of remains for medical studies and scientific research, unclaimed remains may be used by medical schools and scientific institutions for studies and research subject. Under the Revised Administrative Code, use of dead body for scientific purpose, unclaimed body which is buried at public expense for a period of 24 hours after death shall be subject to the disposition of the Bureau of Health for purposes of medical science and medical information. Okay, these are just matters of reading. They are provisions of law. They are self-explanatory. Under the Revised Penal Code, Article 85, provisions relative to the corpse of the person executed and its burial. Again, unless claimed by family, the corpse of culprit shall, upon completion of the legal proceeding subsequent to the execution, to be turned over to institute for study and investigation. The director of prisons shall order the burial of the body of the culprit at government expense, granting permission to be present thereat to the members of the family of the culprit. Okay, Code of Sanitation, Section 98. Special precautions for safe handling of cadavers containing radioactive isotopes. Cadavers containing only traces, very small dose of radioactive isotope do not require any special handling precautions. Okay. However, cadavers containing large amounts of radioactive isotopes should be labeled properly, identifying the type and amount of radioactive isotopes present and the date of its administration. Before autopsy is performed, radiation health officer or his duly authorized representative should be notified for proper advice. Normal burial procedures, rules, and regulations may be carried out on above mentioned cadaver, provided that their amount of radioactivity has decayed to safe level, which will be determined by radiation health officer. If cremation performed without autopsy, there is no handling problem. Otherwise, autopsy precautions should be strictly enforced because radioactive dead bodies are dangerous. Precautions should be taken to prevent any possible concentration of radioactivity at the base of the stack of the crematorium. Now, let's go to organ donation. Okay? Donation of parts of human body. Permission to use human organs or portions of the human body for medical, surgical, or scientific purposes under certain conditions. So, this is an example. Hope Lee, a newborn girl from Britain, becomes world's youngest organ donor. She lived for 72 minutes only, but saved the life of a 20-year-old girl by donating kidneys and liver cells. Okay, so hopefully the youngest hero, okay, an organ donor at the age of 74 minutes only, but she donated her organ. Okay, Republic Act Number 349 as amended by Republic Act 1056. So this is an act to legalize permissions to use human organs or any portion or portions of the human body for medical, surgical, or scientific purposes under certain conditions. Okay? So this is the basis. This is the organic law of organ donation. Section 1 of the said law. Any person may validly grant to a licensed physician, surgeon, or any medical or scientific institution. At any time after the grantor's death, any organ, part or parts of his body, and to utilize the same for medical, surgical, or scientific purposes. Okay? Now, section 2. The section must be referred to in authorization of this act are in writing. Specify the patient, person, or institution granted the authorization, the organ or parts to be detached, the specific use or uses to which the organ or parts are to be employed, and signed by the grantor and two disinterested witnesses. Okay? So, the process is any organ donation should be documented. It must be in writing and must have at least two witnesses, disinterested witnesses. Okay? By disinterested witnesses, it means the witnesses must not be a relative within fourth degree of consanguinity or affinity. Okay? So, if the grantor is a minor or an incompetent person and the authorization may be executed by his guardian with the approval of the court, in default thereof, by the legitimate father or mother in the order named. Okay? So, if the grantor is incompetent or is a minor, then the guardian must assist in the process of donating organs. Or if not the court, the legitimate father or mother in that order. Okay? So, these are provisions of law. These are matters of reading. I will be giving you copies of the laws that we have discussed so far. So, married women may grant the authorization referred to in the Section 1 of this Act without the consent of the husband. After the death of the person, authority to use human organs or any portion or portions of the human body for medical, surgical, or scientific purposes may also be granted by his nearest relative or guardian at the same time of his death or in the absence thereof by the person or head of the hospital or institution having custody of the deceased, provided, however, that the said person or head of the hospital or institution has exerted reasonable effort to locate the aforesaid guardian or relative, okay? So, this is if there are no claimants of the body, okay? There are no relatives that can sign, then the hospital or any person which has custody of the body can sign the donation in his behalf. Okay? So, these are the organs that can be transplanted to another person. Okay? So, the heart, if persons having congenital heart disease or coronary artery diseases, cardiomyopathy, valvular heart diseases, in case of the lung, those persons having chronic obstructive pulmonary diseases, emphysema, pulmonary fibrosis, hypertension, congenital defect. In case of a liver, hepatitis, biliary disease, tumors, liver cancer, cirrhosis, etc. In case of kidney, diabetes, high blood pressures, end-stage renal failure, polycystic kidney diseases. In case of pancreas, type 1 diabetes, without renal disease, hypoglycemic unawareness, pancreas after kidney transplant. Small intestines, short gut syndrome, severe vascular disease, children with intestinal failure who can't absorb nutrients from food. Okay? This is a physiologic condition. So, life-saving transplantations are needed on these body parts, corneas, to restore loss of vision, cornea infection or injury, tendons and ligaments, sports injuries such as replacing an ACL, anterior cruciate ligament, restore mobility for patients undergoing joint restoration, heart valves, replace damaged heart valves, veins, coronary artery bypass surgery, repair damaged vessels to produce blood flow, create hemodialysis fistula, skin, temporary biological bandages for burn victims, diabetic wound repairs, mastectomy, rotator cuff reconstruction, and abdominal wall reinforcement. Bones, replace or reconstruct bones destroyed by cancerous tumors, trauma, or infection. Used in dental, spine, and neck surgeries. Probabilities, so donation potential. Fewer than 4% of people die in a hospital on a ventilator in a manner that allows for the potential of organ donation. Lack of knowledge and awareness. More registered donors are needed, providing first-person legal authorization for organ, tissue, and eye donation for transplant research and education. Okay? So, for those person who wants to donate, they must be abreast of the legalities, okay? Because one requirement of which is it must be in writing, okay? Disproportionately high racial and ethnic needed. African Americans, Hispanics, Latinos, Asians, Pacific Islanders, and Native Americans are 3 times more likely than Caucasian to suffer from kidney diseases, leading to end-stage renal diseases. Section 3. An authorization granted in accordance with the provision of this Act shall bind the executors, administrators, and successors of the deceased and all members of his family. So, these are binding to the heirs. Such authorizations are already binding to the heirs, okay? Whether compulsory or otherwise. Any law or regulation inconsistent with the Act are hereby repealed. This Act shall take effect upon its approval immediately. So this Act was approved on June 12, 1954. The amendment. But the original Act was approved May 17, 1949. So this is an old law, a Jurassic law which is still operational nowadays. Code of Sanitation, Section 96. Any person may donate an organ or any part of his body to a person, a physician, a scientist, a hospital, or a scientific institution upon his death for transplant, medical, or research purposes, subject to the following requirements. The donation shall be authorized in writing by the donor, specifying the recipient, the organ or part of his body to be donated, and the specific purpose for which it will be utilized. A married person may make such donation without the consent of his spouse. So it can be done personally without the consent of your spouse. A simple written authorization signed by the donor in the presence of 2 witnesses shall be deemed sufficient for the donation of organs or parts of the human body required in this section, notwithstanding the provisions of the Civil Code of Philippines on matters of donation. A copy of written authorization shall be forwarded to the secretary. Okay? Because under Philippine law, there are rules with regards to donation. However, donation of body parts is a special kind of donation which is embodied in the Organ Donation Act of the Philippines. However, we can also use other provisions of law like the Civil Code in its suppletory character, okay, in order to supplement the Organ Donation Act. Any authorization granted in accordance with the requirements of this section is binding to the executors, administrators, and members of the family of the deceased. Okay? Permission, how acquired, okay? How to get the consent for organ donation. So, if it is before death, permission is by the deceased during his lifetime. That's the first. Second, if the deceased is a minor or incompetent, permission may be executed by the guardian with the approval of the court or by the legitimate father or mother. A married woman may give consent without the consent of the husband. After death, consent or permission is taken by the nearest relative. In the absence of the nearest relative, permission may be given by the head of the hospital or institution having custody of the deceased. Organ detachment and uses. Persons permitted to detach human organs or parts of the human body for medical, surgical, and other scientific uses. This list are exclusive. Licensed physicians and surgeons, known scientists, medical or scientific institutions, including eye banks. Importance of organ tissue and eye donation. Okay, registered donors. Registered donors have the power to save lives. Registering as a donor is a charitable act with no cost. Registered donors have legally authorized their gift. Okay? Recipients. Organ donation gives recipients a second chance at life. Tissue and eye donation gives recipients the ability to heal, freedom from pain, or the ability to see again. Donors and their families. A family receives some comfort during their time of grief when a loved one is able to be a donor. Families have some consolation that their loss helps save or improve the lives of others. Okay, this picture right here shows what organ donation is all about, okay? Parents listen to their son's transplanted heartbeat in the chest of the recipient of his gift. There is only one race, the human race, okay? The person was given a new lease in life due to organ donation. That's why organ donation law is one of the best law, okay? So we should support that law. Now, let's go to the requirements for a valid authorization. First, it must be in writing. It must specify the person or institution granted the authorization. It must specify the organ or part of the body to be detached. It must be signed by the grantor and two disinterested persons. A copy of the authorization must be furnished to the Secretary of Health. So, these are the mandatory requirement for a valid organ donation. Limitation and penal provision. It will be illegal to remove organs or portion of the human body if the deceased died of a dangerous communicable diseases. Okay? So, if a person has died due to a infectious disease, then organ donation is not feasible. Okay? It can be denied by law. Imprisonment of not less than 6 months nor more than 1 year if committed by an institution or other officials or employees who knowingly or through neglect performed an act or acts resulting in said violation shall be criminally responsible. Now, let's go to exhumation, okay? Or the digging up of the body. Exhumation means the order may come from provincial or city fiscals, from court for buried, to be raised or decentered upon the lawful order of proper authorities. Strictly, no deodorant should be applied because it might interfere in the detection of chemicals during post-mortem. The physician may describe coffin, clothing, before stating actual disease. After the body has been decentered, it must be identified by relatives, friends, or marks on the body. So, one purpose for digging up or exhuming a body is to further investigate, okay, the cause of the death of the person or study the DNA of the person. Under the revised administrative code again of the Philippines, it shall be unlawful to establish, reopen, or remove any burial ground or to decenter a human body until a permit approved by the Director of Health shall have been obtained. Okay? So, the exhumation of bodies must be with the authority, okay? Must be, a permit should be secured, okay? Otherwise, you will be liable. So, the question arises, is the National Bureau of Investigation required to obtain a permit from the Director of Health for exhumation of the dead body in course of legal investigation? Okay? The answer is yes. Opinion by Secretary of Justice under the Administrative Code requiring permit of the Director of Health. So, without this authority from the Director of Health, even if you are a government agency like the Bureau of National Bureau of Investigation, then you will still be liable, okay? Because only the Director of Health can give permit in exhumation. No exception should be made following this act because the purpose of permit is the protection of health which may not be sacrificed. Under the revised administrative code again, permit to decenter after 3 years, treatment of remains. Permission to decenter the bodies or remains of person who have died of communicable disease may be granted after such bodies have been buried for a period of 3 years. In special cases, the Director of Health may be granted permission to decenter after a shorter period when public health will not be in danger. That is why it is the Director of Health that will give the permit because he will still investigate or study the case of giving the permit whether or not the public will be in danger due to health risk. The body or remains of any such deceased person upon exhumation shall be immediately disinfected and enclosed in a coffin, case, or a box. Section 1096 of the Revised Administrative Code of the Philippines, special permit to disinter embalmed body or to remove from receiving vault for transfer. Special permits may be issued for exhumation of remains of person dying of other than dangerous communicable diseases that have been properly embalmed for transfer or removal of bodies that have been placed in a receiving vault awaiting transportation from the Philippines. Boxes having the body should be properly named. Cause, place of death should be mentioned. Okay, these are just matters of reading. These are actual provisions of the law. Okay, refer to your book. Administrative Code of the Philippines again. Exhumation in case of death from dangerous communicable disease. Bodies or remains of person who have been died of any dangerous communicable diseases may be exhumed only after lapse of 5 years from burial, though in special cases the Director of Health may grant shorter period, okay, 5 years. In every case, the body or remains after being disinfected must be placed in a suitable hermetically sealed container. So, the Code of Sanitation, disinterment requirements. Permission to disinter remains of a person who died of non-dangerous communicable diseases may be granted after a burial period of 3 years. Okay? 3 years. But if the person died with dangerous communicable diseases, 5 years. Both the above act of disinterment of remains should be permitted within shorter period than that prescribed in the special cases. In all cases of disinterment, the remains shall be disinfected and placed in a durable and sealed container prior to final disposal. So, under Article 308 of the Civil Code, no human should be kept in the tomb, disposed of, exhumed without the consent of the person mentioned in Article 294 and 305. So, these persons are the spouse, descendants of the nearest degree, ascendants of the nearest degree, brothers and sisters. So, consent should be given by these persons. Okay. So, how long can exhumation be done after interment? Condition 1. If the person died of dangerous communicable disease, the dead body may be exhumed only after a lapse of 5 years from the date of burial. Some exceptions are dig up may be given after a shorter period when in the opinion of the Director of Health, it will not endanger public health. Okay, same rule also under the Administrative Code, exhumation in case of death from dangerous communicable disease. So, the Director of Health will give the permit after the span of 5 years if the person who will be digged up has suffered a dangerous disease. So, in special cases, the Director of Health may grant a permit to dig up after a shorter period when, in his opinion, the public health will not be endangered thereby. So, Sanitation Code, disinterment requirements, permission to dig out remains of persons who died of dangerous communicable diseases, the same shall be granted after 5 years. Okay? Condition 2. If a person died of a cause other than dangerous communicable disease, permission for exhumation may be granted after such body had been buried for a period of 3 years. Okay? So, under normal circumstance, 3 years. If the dead body has a communicable disease before he died, 5 years. Some exception. In a special case, the Director of Health may grant permission after a shorter period when in his opinion, the public health will not be endangered thereby. So, one requirement for earlier time of exhumation is that public health will not be endangered. Revised Administrative Code, permit to disinter after 3 years treatment of remains. So, permission to dig out the body or remains of persons who have died of other than dangerous communicable disease may be granted after such bodies had been buried for a period of 3 years. Okay, exception the same if public health is not endangered. Condition 3. Okay, permission to disinter the body who have died of other than dangerous communicable diseases may be granted after such bodies had been buried for a period of 3 years again. Okay? Different laws, the Sanitation Code, the Administrative Code of the Philippines, the Civil Code of the Philippines, okay? They supplement each other. That's why provisions always came out the same. Okay? So again, under the code of sanitation, disinterment requirement, if non-communicable diseases, 3 years. Okay? If communicable, 5 years. Condition 4. If the body is a subject matter of criminal investigation, it may be exhumed at any time. Okay? Autopsy shall be performed in the following cases. Whenever the Solicitor General, provincial, as authorized by existing laws, shall consider it necessary to dig out and take out possession of the remains for examination to determine the cause of death. Requirements to be satisfied in exhumation. Duration of interment as required, and then exhumation permit. Under the administrative code, cemetery permits, it shall be unlawful to establish, reopen, to disinter a human body or human remains until a permit, therefore, approved by the Director of Health shall have been obtained. So it is a condition sine qua non or a condition precedent that a permit must first be issued. Compliance of the sanitary requirements. So permit to disinter after 3 years. The body or remains of any such deceased person upon exhumation shall be immediately disinfected and enclosed in a certain coffin as securely fastened, and this coffin shall be placed in an outside box which shall also be securely fastened. Under code of sanitation, in all cases of disinterment, the remains shall be disinfected and placed in a durable and sealed container prior to their final disposal. Okay? Different laws supplementing each other. Procedure followed in medico-legal examination. First, there must be a formal request from any of the law enforcement agency or person authorized to perform medico-legal investigation. The request must mention the name of the deceased, place of interment, date of interment, suspicion as to the cause of death, etc. The reasons for the request may be to determine the cause of death, to determine the identity of the deceased, to recover organs or tissues for further examination, okay? Like DNA testing, or to know the cause of the disease, to perform autopsy again, okay? So, examination includes but not limited to for toxicological analysis, for histopathological examination, smears from vaginal canal, and blood for alcohol determination. To recover foreign bodies, metallic fragment or whole slug for ballistic examination, operative sponge, medical instrument to prove negligence of the surgeon. Okay? These are the reasons for exhumation. If the physician found out that there is justification to the exhumation and a strong probability for the purpose to be realized, he may then set the date and time of the exhumation. A written request for exhumation of the body of the deceased must be sent to the Minister of Health or the regional director concerned, mentioning among other things like the name of the deceased, place of exhumation, date and time of exhumation, duration of interment, purpose of exhumation. Okay? So during actual exhumation, the grave must be properly identified by the person who was present when the body was buried. During the process of disinterment, care and perseverance must be observed to avoid destruction, deformity, contamination, or such other effects that will prevent the realization of its objective, okay? So that the body will not be contaminated. After opening the coffin, the body must be viewed by any or more persons who can identify the dead body. The names of the person who identified the grave, who viewed and identified the deceased, must be included in the report. The exhuming physician must describe the coffin, wearing apparel, and condition of the body. So these are documentation. Actual autopsy and adoption of the procedure is needed to accomplish the purpose of exhumation. Disinfection of the body and all the areas involved must be carried out with assistance of the local health officer and return of the body to the burial place. Okay, these are just matter of readings. What must be included in the exhumation report? The name of the deceased and the personal circumstances like age, sex, civil status, address, occupation. Purpose of exhumation. The name, address, and designation of the requesting party. The date, time, and place of exhumation. The description of the buried place. The name and address of persons who identify the burial place. The condition of the body and the coffin after disinterment. Okay? These are just matters of documentation. The name and address of the persons who identify the body of the deceased. The post-mortem examination and accomplishment of the purposes of the exhumation. The conclusion based on the findings and result of the examination. Remarks, if any. The signature and designation of the physician. Some problems in exhumation. Okay, these are problems that can happen along the way. Identity of the deceased. The exhumed buried deceased might not be subject matter of exhumation, especially when the burial ground is a cemetery. Mass burial of salvaging victims may cause serious problems to the physician. There must be a careful and time-consuming attempt of the exhuming physician to establish identity in order that this report may be of some value in the investigative or judicial proceeding. Okay? All will redound to becoming the evidence. Okay? The purpose of exhumation is to find evidence. Okay, another problem you can encounter is the refusal of the next of kin to give consent or to cooperate in the exhumation autopsy. This situation is frequently observed when the person's closest relatives has a strong possibility to be involved in the investigation. Okay, if the relatives has something to hide. The proper remedy to this situation is to request the court to issue an order to exhume the body, stating the specific reasons why exhumation autopsy will serve the best interest of justice. So, if the next of kin will not allow it, petition the court, okay? And the court will order the exhumation. And the relatives cannot do anything about it because it is a court order. Should petition the court in the interest of justice and fair play. Okay, that ends this topic. However, we still have many topics to go. And these discussions are just matters of reading. Okay, most of them are enumerations, definition of terms. Okay, so please refer to your book, and if you have questions, do not hesitate to message or ask me directly, okay? So, thank you and God bless us all.